Many times we come across a concept that it's called Mesirut Nefesh. Mesirut Nefesh, everybody says Mesirut Nefesh, and so on and so forth. What is exactly Mesirut Nefesh? Well, most of the time people are, you know, when we use the term Mesirut Nefesh, it is a concept that we use to describe a tremendous act of selflessness, act of dedication, great dedication. So the question is, why do we use that term, Mesirut Nefesh? Just say, it's a complete act of selflessness, or wow, it's a great act of dedication. What does it mean, Mesirut Nefesh? So let's look at exactly what does it mean, Mesirut Nefesh. There is, of course, maybe we'll get to it a little further, the different parts of the neshama, of the soul. There is the nefesh, which is in charge of all your functioning of your body, which is just eating, drinking, multiplying, and so on and so forth. That's the engine of the person. There's the ruach, there's the neshama, but sometimes the word nefesh refers to just a human soul, just like plain human soul. Mesirut nefesh, limsor, is to hand over, like the word masorah, tradition, masorah, something that I would hand over to you. So it's handing over your soul. What does it mean to hand over your soul? So the first example that comes to my mind of handing over one soul, it really has to do with the death of Moshe Rabbeinu. We know, we read last week's parasha, it's a very interesting command of a Kadosh Baruch Hu when he tells Moshe, Ale Elahar, you climb up to the mountain of Briot, Ale Elahar, Umut, and die there. It's almost a command what does it mean? You want me to die there? What do you want to kill myself? What do you want me to do? What does it mean? And die there. The Mekubalim tell us what happens there. It's called mot neshika. It's dying with a kiss. What does it mean? When Moshe Rabbeinu went to the mountain, went to that cave where he was ultimately buried, Har Nevo, and it was this great wisdom, the Torah says, and nobody knows his grave. I guess Moshe Rabbeinu is the first recorded missing in action, like many soldiers that we don't know where he's buried. And there's a tremendous continuous grief to deal with the fact that you don't know the death of a close person to you. You know, the place, the burial place where, you know, is a very difficult concept to deal with. At least sometimes the Kriya just give me something so I have a grave to mourn on. But yet, with the great wisdom that Torah says, I'm not going to tell you where it is because I don't want you to start making pilgrimage and, you know, make a business out of this like anything else. But when Moshe climbed to the mountain, Mekubalim tell us he immersed himself, in English terms, let's call it a deep meditation, where practicing different manipulations of the holy name and so on and so forth, dwelling inside, he reached a point in which his soul, what happens in those high-level meditations, your soul, or at least a part of your soul, separates from the body. And it is possible, without getting to it now, or if I tell you that, it will be off the camera. He reached a certain level, and we see the story of the Mishnah in Masechet Chagigah. It talks about the four sages who enter the Pardes, enter the heavenly realm, and one of them died. What does it mean, he died? He went into meditation and he died. Again, meditation that refer to in the Torah or in Jewish sources is not sitting down doing hum, hum. You know, we don't do that hum, hum. He died because there was no point of coming back. We know that he didn't have children, so therefore there was no point of him coming back. So the soul simply was outrooted from the body and never wanted to come back, because what's the point? After you've seen what you've seen, what's the point of coming back? And of course, if you analyze each and every one of those fours, there's a different story, a different reason why whatever happened to them happened to them. Moshe Rabbeinu was able to reach such a high level of dying through handing over his soul to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Malach HaMavet, we said that Malach HaMavet, the angel of death, right? It's not Satan, it's the angel of death. His job is to come in and take the souls out. He's a collector, you know? He couldn't do it. He couldn't pull Moshe Rabbeinu's soul out of, separate the soul out of the body. Couldn't. And the separation of the soul from the body is a very difficult ordeal, most part. Even the Gemara says sometimes it will be like pulling a thread from a cotton from a bundle, or a needle from a bundle. You know, some things. And sometimes, if you're very obsessed with your body, it will be like ripping up, piece. You know, it's just a very difficult thing. The soul, in a way, sometimes becomes corrupted with the body. It doesn't want to descend. It doesn't want to separate. It's stuck here. Moshe Rabbeinu was able to reach such a high level that he handed over his soul. Neshika. Neshika, we say in Hebrew, is a kiss. But that's not really what it really means. The word kiss, what does it mean to kiss in English? If I tell you to kiss, can you explain to me what does it mean to kiss, right? Is there a meaning to the word rather than just a collection of sounds? Kiss, we all know it's a kiss. Kiss, right? That's a kiss. However, that's not a kiss in Hebrew. Hashaka is, for example, in mikveh, when there is a mikveh, there is the body of the water, which is the rainwater, which is collected. And then there is that pool in which you immerse yourself. You don't immerse yourself in the body of water because rain is very precious, and other concerns as well. So what do? We have a opening, kishvoferet anot, which is about two fingers. And when there is sufficient amount of water, that's why the mikveh is tahor, and if there's sufficient amount of water in the reservoir of the rainwater, we simply open that opening, that little connection part, and the water touch each other, become one. That's called hashaka, lehashik, almost to inaugurate, to become one. Neshika is when you kiss someone, it's not going like, you know, air kissing like everybody's doing. The real kiss is a kiss that you become one when your lips come together and your nose and your breath becomes one, and you becoming one through that. That is not an affection of a matter of sexuality. That's a act of great spiritual affection. You know, we got it all wrong. Again. Kiss is a very powerful statement. So, Mot Neshika is when you're dying through emerging of its soul, your soul with its source above. The soul is connected, doesn't come back, and then you're dead. Therefore, you see, your body is no more than a pile of meat. Without your soul, your body is nothing. So what is Mesirut Nefesh, handing over your soul? Handing over your soul is being very selfless. That you are willing to give up something that you don't exist. When a person, for example, is a, you know, regular Jew, secular Jew, no. And he's willing to give up his title. And by the way, a great person is measured by his willingness to learn. Because if I am great, right, and I have a title, let's say I'm a doctor, or I'm a this, or I'm a that, to most people, this is the end of learning. I'm a doctor. You go, well, I have a PhD. I'm going to sit down, I'm going to teach you. You're not going to be teaching me. That is, by the way, death. But a person like that, right, he's not going to sit down and now sit in the back of the row. Remember what we talked yesterday about dedication. You know, if you missed, you know, a few months, you're going back to the end of the row, right? That is a very beautiful concept. You were here yesterday? You were here. What we say is there are certain types of martial arts. Again, that's learning from everybody. Do you expect it to attend out of dedication every day, or you know, a certain amount of days a week? And then when you don't attend, let's say you all of a sudden are gone for like 3 months, 2 months, when you're coming back, you, regardless of your ranking, you go on your white belt, the back of the row, as a respect to those who actually came when you didn't. So a person like this, imagine now he's a doctor. He decides to be Chozer B'Tshuva, to keep Shabbat. Now he's going to come to yeshiva, or he's going to come to learn, and he's not going to mind the fact that he doesn't know anything. He's going to sit there and he's going to learn basics. He could be 50 years old learning from an 18-year-old. He doesn't need to prove anything. That is a flexible mind. That is a mind worthy. If you need to prove all the time that you can keep up, and it happens many times when you have older people being taught by younger people, they always have a tendency to prove. They need to prove something. They need to prove something. They need to prove this. They need to prove that. Or you need to prove that you're smart. Or you need to prove that you're this. Or you need to prove that you're that. You are not busy learning. You're busy trying to prove something. And therefore you stay the same idiot as you were before. Nothing has changed. Actually, maybe a bigger idiot, because now you have an opportunity to learn, and you're actually not learning, you're just trying to prove. One of my martial arts teachers used to say that when he's a religious guy. He used to say when his students become black belts, he sends them to learn something else completely new. Go start fresh, something. Humble yourself. Go learn. This is just the beginning. Mesirut Nefesh is a person who, regardless of what everybody's going to tell him, listen, what are you, crazy? Are you going not to learn? What are you doing with these kids? That has nothing to do with the people around you. It has to do with your willingness to learn. So therefore, it would not bother you that you're 50 years old and there's around you 16-year-old people that actually probably know Gemara or know whatever better than you. You don't care. It doesn't make a difference. I'm here to learn. They know something that I don't know. I don't care that they're 16 and I'm 50. I'm learning. Regardless of what other people will tell you. So even if this guy does not become a Talmid Chacham, I want to become a rabbi. You want to become a rabbi? You're a fool. Because you don't understand. Even if you did not become a rabbi, and you did not become this huge Talmid Chacham, yes, you might be big in physics and biology and whatever it is. However, you did not become a Talmid Chacham. You made your decisions at the time, but you learned that moment, that you decided to leave this behind, regardless of what the people laugh at you, that is the moment of Mesirut Nefesh. That's the moment that you became one with Ribono Shel Olam. You didn't care what people would do to you, what people would laugh. But you, a guy like you, so smart, I just don't understand. Why would you go and make some money? Why do you sit down learning Gemara all day long, learning Halakha all day long? Go make some money. You're so smart. You're doing so well. He said, no. I'm learning. At that moment, you said, no, I'm learning. Regardless of the outcome, you made yourself one with the Kadosh Baruch Hu. I don't understand one thing. How could anybody ever regret such a statement of making himself one with the Kadosh Baruch Hu, when your soul is connected? This is, Is this the highest level of person? I mean, don't we all want to reach a level of like Moshe Rabbeinu? Why do we want to reach a level like Moshe Rabbeinu? Can you explain to me why? I'll tell you why. Because you want the fame and glory. You want to be like Moses. Right, Moses? Everybody wants to be like Mike, not like Moses, right? He wants to be like Moses. Moshe Rabbeinu. You want the fame and glory. You don't want the connection with Ribono Shel Olam. You're not interested in that. You're fake, to a certain extent. Or you're weak. Because you don't think that without glory, you could actually achieve something. If you are trying to achieve something for people's recognition, you know, you are a commodity. But you're doing what you're doing because that's what you need to do. Whether you're Tyler, whether, you know, I know people who are huge, I'm telling you, huge, huge Talmidei Chachamim. Unbelievable scholars. But they don't have a certificate that says a rabbi. He says, what do I need it? You know, I'm learning. I know everything. What do I need? Just for the right. If I need it, I'll go somewhere. I'll give it to me 2 seconds. And yet, I know people with the title rabbi that know absolutely nothing. That's Mesirut Nefesh, is handing your soul over for a cause. During this time of Aseret Yemei Teshuva, we need to understand what does it mean Mesirut Nefesh. What is the whole process of tshuva? Is regardless of what people will tell you, you need to do what you need to do. You're handing your neshama over. You show complete trust, not only in Ribono Shel Olam, in everything that is evolved around it, the Torah and Chachamim and your Jewish, in yourself as well. And that's something that we're lacking very much. If I want to give something over, is what? Then what do I get in return? What do I get in return? What bothers me a lot is the fact that, you know, and in many fields, that we have to, it has to come down to, if you want me to teach you something, guess what? You gotta pay me. You gotta pay me. Okay, fine. So let's say you need to pay. Did you pay your dues to God who gave you that talent? Huh? No, you didn't pay him the dues. Only when it comes to yourself you want to get paid. If somebody wants, you know, let's say you have a, you know, something that you did. And somebody says, listen, I wanna see something. Can I? No, only if you're a paying member. Fine, not a problem. Let me ask you, were you born with this talent, or did you come up with it with yourself? How did you get your talent to do whatever you're doing? Let's say, for example, a guy is doing a ballet. You know, I want to learn this dance. Excuse me, if you're not a member of my studio, I cannot give you my, you know. Okay, fine, it's not a problem. But did you pay your dues to the one who gave you this talent? Why does it have to be all about money and so on and so forth? When we do it like that, we lose out. It should be that you're willing to teach me and you are willing to learn from me. It's fine. As a gratitude, you should say, listen, you know, it's your time. I'll pay you for your time. But it shouldn't be a demand on my behalf for you to pay me. Or you don't have enough money. You can't come to our schools. That's painful. Imagine a Kadosh Baruch Hu would have said to us, hey guys, you want the Torah? If not a problem. Let me see, please, your tax return. How much money you make? What kind of car do you drive? When was the last time you went on vacation? Where did you go on vacation? What have you done lately? Did you paint your house? Did you renovate your house? Oh, I'm sorry, we have no money. But then what will happen? We will not have Torah. Mesirut Nefesh is doing things because it needs to be done without thinking too much about yourself. Handing your soul over. And their act of Mesirut Nefesh is the complete act of bitachon in HaKadosh Baruch Hu, emunah in HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that He will provide you. He will do, I need to do what I need to do, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu always does what He needs to do, but I need to do it. Again, excuse me, Chovat HaAdam BeOlamo, understanding what is your job in your world, will help you reach your level of Mesirut Nefesh. Not always what you wanted to be out of yourself. Not always what people told you they want you to be. But knowing deep down inside what you were meant to be, what you were meant to do, regardless of all the people who would laugh at you. You have bitachon in Hashem. You have emunah. You have a flexible mind that's willing to learn. You'll make it. You won't. You might be famous. You might be rich. But as far as I'm concerned, you didn't make it. Think about it very carefully and try to be moser nefesh, sacrificing from yourself, giving from yourself, a part of your soul, giving for a cause that is great. It's a tremendous act of satisfaction when you find it within yourself to give even a piece, give a little piece of my heart now. So you should say, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, take a piece of my heart, take a piece of my neshama. I'm willing to give this for a cause. I'm willing to give a little bit of my fame and my glory for a cause that is greater than me. I'm willing to do so, not a problem. And that is an act of a tremendous closeness to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And ultimately, isn't that what we all should be looking and should be asking? Have a great day.